Good evening and welcome to the Newmarket School Board meeting for the date of September 18, 2008. I'd like to call the meeting to order at this time. If we can begin by having Sean Riley lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to welcome everybody tonight, those people viewing at home, and explain a couple of absences that you see in front of you tonight. There is a joint town council selectman meeting between the towns of Newmarket, Madbury, Lee, and Durham. At least they have all been invited in the basement this evening. And Mr. Chase, Cliff Chase, is attending that meeting, as is Mr. Bergeron, certainly as a member of our town council. Their overall purpose is to discuss economies of scale that could be achieved between the multiple communities in the area of public schools. And it, Mr. Chase felt it important for him to attend that meeting. It is certainly my hope, and speaking for myself personally, that if these meetings continue in the future, that the boards with actual statutory authority are invited to participate in this discussion, as opposed to having these discussions happen in isolation. Welcome to visitors. At this point, if there's any public comment, this is the time for that to take place.
I guess, I'm sorry, I'd just like to introduce myself.
Sir, if you'll step to the microphone, please, because viewers at home can't hear you unless you're there.
Good evening. I just wanted to introduce myself real quick. My name's Nathan Ritzo, and I'm the Seacoast Media Group correspondent for Newmarket now, and I'm going to be covering the meeting tonight, as well as I covered the last two meetings the last two nights as well. So I just wanted to introduce myself. Thank you.
Thank you and welcome. We're glad to have you. We'll move right through our minutes, seeing no other speakers. I'd have a motion for the approval of our September 4th minutes.
I'll make a motion to accept the September 4th minute meetings as written.
I'll second that.
There's been a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Next would be our town council's report. Of course, Mr. Bergeron, as I explained, is not here. I'd entertain a motion to move our teachers' presentation up in our agenda at this time in order to, you know, make best use of their time.
I'll make a motion to adjust the agenda to have the teachers do their presentation.
I'll second that.
Was that a second, Chet?
Yes.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Welcome. We have the teachers from Science Department here with us to share with us a staff development program that they took part in over the summer in the Florida Keys. So this was sounds like it was very exciting. I think they found it very worthwhile, and they're here to tell us and via television the community about it. Welcome.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Janice Murray. I'm the sixth grade science teacher in Newmarket here. And every summer, we make an attempt to do a staff development that can bring something back to Newmarket students that they wouldn't get in another way. I won't bore you with what we've done in the past, because I know that you're privy to that information already. But before I start, I just wanted to make sure that we thanked the Newmarket School District for their financial support for this program. The Newmarket Community Education Partnership also was part of the financial backing for this, and we also had an anonymous benefactor that we need to thank as well. This picture is the Marine Resources Development Foundation in Key Largo, Florida. They were established in 1970. They are nonprofit, and their goal is to use the Florida Keys to educate students and teachers so that they can become stewards for their environment. Historically, they've also been backed by NOAA, which we all know and respect as a water resource that we've all used in Newmarket in the past. These were our accommodations up top. It was very warm, but that was the only air-conditioned space, so we were there as much as we can. Could be. The top right photo is the logo that they used, and as I explained, it talks about using education and adventure to create stewardships amongst the human race, anyone that they can get down there. And they are all funded by what it costs to get there, pretty much, and whatever they can get for donations. The bottom left is a mural that we were able to enjoy on our way out in the boats as we went snorkeling and did some of our restoration projects. The bottom right was the cafeteria that we ate in three times a day. And here's our group. This is mangrove restoration, and this creates a barrier to hurricanes on the lands where we were. Mangroves used to grow there, but they were taken out to build, commercial facilities in the area. And now that it's been taken over by an environmental group, the job is to put the mangroves back, to add the protection back. So you can see Greg and Kristen in that photo. And what they're doing is using PVC pipe and putting in seaweed. And what they put on top of that is a seed called a propagule that actually falls from mature mangroves. And we're replanting them to get them to grow so that that environment can be rebuilt. Right behind Kristen, there smiling in the hat, is some greenery that's happened in years past, because it's an ongoing project. It will take quite some time to build that back up to what it should look like. On the right-hand side is one of our floating labs, and as I said, that was the planting of the pods called propagules. This is mature mangroves that we were able to enjoy as part of the exploration that we had there. And Linda and I, when we're parking in the mangroves, learning more about them and how they reproduce and what they do for the environment and what kind of habitat they afford to the animals there. This was snorkeling in the mangroves, which for me was one of the most enjoyable snorkels that we had, because it was less intimidating. Sharks don't hang out there. So that was easier for me to breathe. Not quite as deep as being in the coral reefs. And the roots of the mangroves go all the way down to the floor of the ocean, or of that water. So there's lots of animals there to be seen. Hundreds of jellyfish and anemones and colorful fish that we wouldn't see up here. And now I'm going to pass this along.
Kind of four parts of the trip. Conveniently, you saw the logo was divided into four, and one of the four things was the marine undersea laboratories. And there's not very many of these around, and kind of small world. There's two in that little lagoon that you saw on the first slide. They have two of these undersea laboratories. There's one where they do strictly science research, which is the one shown there, and you can kind of see that fish tank bubble thing. That's a dry, you go in from the inside and you can go down and kind of be in the fishbowl looking out, which is pretty cool. We didn't get to go in it at all. This was mostly for the divers, so we just learned about it. But there's a porthole up on the side where you can't see, and you can come down and look at, you can kind of be in the ocean and be dry. But there's bunks in there. You can sleep in there, stay overnight in there. And then there was another one that is actually called the Jules Underwater Lodge, where you can actually rent it like a hotel. You can, save it for three nights and go and live underwater for 3 days. And it's pretty cool. But we didn't get to do any of those because none of us were certified divers, but that's all set up there at the lab. And they use these research vessels, different varieties of these. These are pretty stationary and stay in the cove, but there's other ones of these that they actually take divers down, because one of the hard thing about diving is actually adjusting to the depth. And you've probably all heard of the bends. If you come up too fast or go down too fast, it's much harder to go down too fast, but it's very easy to come up too fast. And adjusting to the pressure is one of the hard things about diving. And having these manned underwater stations where you can live down there for 3 weeks and do your research and not have to go through that decompression state is very important. And they got into a lot of teaching us about the hydrogen mixtures, and people are actually breathing like oxygen helium mixtures or oxygen nitrogen mixtures, and it keeps the bubbles from expanding in your blood and killing you, doing whatever the bends does. So it was really fascinating, and we didn't get into the diving, but it definitely made us interested in maybe trying that someday. That's the command center, because any of those underwater labs have to be maintained, their environment, the air quality, you know, the what you're breathing plus the temperature. It takes a lot of, you can see all the control boards down on the bottom left there. It's a lot of equipment to keep these things up and running. And you can kind of see the little bunks. It's kind of like sleeping in a boat. It's very close quarters. And over on the right-hand side, there's a little place to bunk. And you actually scuba dive down, and you pop in a hole at the bottom, and you come up, and you can spend, I think they were talking about, like, 3-week trips down there. So pretty neat stuff. And they also had remote submersibles, and they actually do have a program where you can wire in from your classroom and use this little, the one on the top left, little remote submersible, and there's a little course you can try and navigate through. You can have your kids in your classrooms navigate your remote submersible and check out robotics from afar. And the middle one shows you the station where they're at, manning it from right there within the lab setting. But on the far right, they've used their submersibles. This is like a Mediterranean island that has cisterns and stuff. I guess it was a place that was attacked a lot, and they had underground tunnels and big caverns where they'd store water, because they'd have to go months without leaving their, I don't know if they call them castles or what it was, but they use these submersibles now to explore the caverns, and there's all sorts of myths about the wealths of the cities being buried down there. So maybe someday our little submersible will find riches and fund more good science projects. And then another fun trip we did was the turtle hospital, and we got to learn about what basically humanity has done to these poor turtles. A lot of them are hit by boats. A lot of them have disease that's probably caused from, you know, changing, you know, polluted water, basically, or a lot of fertilizer in the water. That we actually got to see a turtle surgery. That was a picture there of the turtle we saw having some cancerous growths removed, basically. And on the bottom right, you really can't see it well at all, but along the back of his shell, he's got a fiberglass thing with lead weights, because he was hit by a boat, and what happened is it created a bubble in his shell, and it made him buoyant. He couldn't dive anymore, which makes it really hard to feed. So they try and do some, I think those turtles never get released back into the wild, because the fiberglass eventually will come off and the weights come off, so they haven't figured out a permanent way to release them. But most of them, they try to fix up and stabilize for a year and then release back into the wild. So the turtle hospital is really neat. And I think that brings us to seagrass beds. Oh, and the mangroves, I just have to say, were really cool as far as the physics and wave propagation goes. If you guys have ever been like in a lake around here and you see a speedboat go by and you see the waves just kind of bash along the shore, the mangroves really just, and she showed us, she picked up the speed and we got a wake going, and the wake hits those mangrove roots and it just dies out immediately. Really cool physics wave propagation, but I'm not sure everybody appreciated that.
Well, my interest was the seagrass beds, and seagrass is very important to the healthy ecosystem of the Florida Keys. Obviously, it's in shallow water because it is a plant, so it needs sunlight. There are many things that the seagrass beds do to maintain the health of the ecosystem out here. One thing they do is they help to clarify or clear the water of sediment by collecting it on their leaves. Another thing that they do is they provide habitat for marine fish and crustaceans. They act as food for manatees and turtles. The roots of the seagrass kind of hold the sediment there, so it protects from erosion of this area when there are storms or wave action. And probably the most important job that the seagrass beds do in this area is that they act as nurseries for young fish, young marine life, a place where the young can hide while they're developing into the adult stage. So not knowing the value of the seagrass beds in the Florida Keys is a real problem, because you can sometimes squander the resource that's right under your feet, literally. And that's one thing that our research lab was trying to make clear to the people who visit there. Take care of the treasures that are right in your own backyard. Here's an example of what can happen to seagrass beds when people don't take care of them. This is what we call prop scars or propeller scars. When boats are traveling in water that's too shallow, the propeller can tear up the seagrass. Other things that can happen, people go snorkeling and they don't realize the proper way to snorkel. And so by standing in the seagrass, you're tearing up this delicate area. And swimmers, you know, when you get out of the boat and you're kind of frolicking around in the water, you don't know that you're really tearing up this precious home for a number of marine life. So what can you do to help this regrow? Habitat restoration was one of the focus of our workshop. One thing that our research lab was trying, with some success, believe it or not, is using bird droppings to help fertilize the seagrass. It doesn't grow back very quickly, so fertilizing might help it reestablish. They were building boxes, roosting boxes, for marine birds that would come. And while they were roosting, they, of course, would lay their droppings in the box, and it all collects down into a PVC pipe and then trickles out into these areas that need to be regrown. Okay. This is clearly not the Florida Keys, but it's the start of my take from my vacation this summer and the work that we did in the Florida Keys back here to Newmarket. I spent a week out in Oregon, the eastern side of Oregon, and went to this national park, the Painted Hills of the John Day Fossil Bed region. And when my husband and I were out there, we were just floored at the beauty of this place and how we were the only people there. We just couldn't understand why this national treasure wasn't attracting more visitors. When we got back to the house that we were staying at, we were speaking to the people who were hosting us, and they had never been to this place, even though they live within 45 minutes of it. And so I started thinking, how much do I not appreciate my own backyard and the stuff that we have here that makes New Hampshire a real treasure? So then when I went to Florida and learned how important it is for even the people of the Florida Keys to take care of the seagrass and the mangroves and the coral reefs, I started thinking, maybe in Newmarket we need to start taking a look at the treasures that are homegrown, like the Great Bay Estuary Reserve out here. This is Sandy Point and the boardwalk that goes out. Eelgrass serves the same kind of purpose that the seagrass down in Florida does. And my take for Newmarket is to bring back our own backyard, teach about the ecology of New Hampshire, and help our kids become better stewards of their own treasured state. And this just proves that we were doing actual science out there. This is rocks with some algae attached that we brought back to the lab, shook out the little critters, and we looked at them under the microscope to see what kind of biodiversity was hiding in just literally one rock. Obviously, the more biodiverse, the healthier the ecosystem.
I'm going to do the part about the reefs, but I just want to say I've been doing programs like this for a long time, and I think one of the things as science teachers that we always have to keep updating and expanding our knowledge base. Science is changing all the time, and there's always new things happening, and it's very important to be aware of it. The reefs are very fragile, and around the world, the reefs are disappearing. So one of the goals of the marine resources is to restore these reefs. They're damaged by, again, propellers, ships crashing, oil spills, pollution, and also global warming. So when we look at these, and you see some of the fish in here, start thinking of that word that Linda just used, biodiversity, because the reefs are one of the most biodiverse areas in the world. We saw many, many different kinds of fish. We actually had to pass a fish test before we could go out and do a count. And so there's lots of different kinds of fish, a lot of coral, brain coral, just an incredible, colorful, interesting place to go snorkeling through. Sometimes even a little bit more exciting. Kristen Kiefaver, we really think now can teach biology because she became the shark person. Every time there was a shark sighted, she was on it. She was on it. Well, I was there one time when she found it, and we got this picture of a nurse shark. That shark's approximately 5 feet long, and we both got within about 3 or 4 feet of it. They're fairly tame sharks. You almost have to force them to bite you, but they're still pretty interesting to see up close and a very exciting thing. And again, we use the word biodiversity. It's not just fish, but reptiles too in that area. And when Linda said about bringing back to New Hampshire what we've done down there, biodiversity is a critical word to use in our own area too, about the different kinds of life forms we found. We found one of these pufferfish, porcupine fish, several different names for them. It was about almost 2.5 feet long. I'd never seen one that big. It was amazing. There's a statue off the coast. It's kind of interesting and it's very pretty. A lot of photographs there and a couple more of the fish. So here we were down there, team building and learning, experimenting. And one of the things, what can we bring back? Well, we've decided in the middle school, 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, is to start taking some of the major habitats of New Hampshire, the forests, the streams, and the ocean, and start to take a week in April when we're going to focus on the ecology of those areas. What's really happening to those areas? What's going on in your own backyard, as Linda said, because there are treasures here. Our seacoast, 18 miles, is a treasure. We have beautiful lakes. We have beautiful forests. We have a second coastline in Great Bay. And it's so close, and yet it's often ignored. So we're going to be trying to put together, we are putting together a program for that. And if you look at this, this is a little bit like the logo that they had for marine resources. So we're going to have our kids in sixth grade, I believe, are doing the forest.
Freshwater.
Sixth grade doing freshwater. Seventh grade is doing saltwater ecology. And eighth grade, we'll be doing forest ecology. We're going to first have the kids kind of make a little picture that'll fit in there that kind of goes along with protecting that environment as part of our week-long program on these three very, very diverse environments, very critical to New Hampshire, both just for the biodiversity, for the life that's there, but very frankly, too, also for one of our biggest industries is tourism. And if these areas go south, well, our tourism will go further south itself. So these are important areas. It's a great trip. These things are very important, and I think one of the things that I want to mention, too, is that these kind of opportunities are open to all different subject areas. We just happen to be a little bit more gung-ho and pushy and find them, but all the subjects can find these kind of great programs around the country. So I want to thank you again for your support, and does anybody else want to toss anything else in? Nope. Thank you very much for giving us the time to present this. And maybe you might have some questions of us, too. Is that just the next button? Nope. Okay.
One more.
Oh, okay. You didn't mean to dock on the whole place up, everybody.
Thank you very much. I know the Sandy Point Discovery happens to be a favorite place of mine, and I know that the grass that you're talking about houses a lot of the ladybugs as they go through their different stages before they hatch. Thousands and thousands of them were there 1 year when we went in, but it's nice to see that You explained very nicely how you take something that you're learning in a different, you know, ecosystem and bring it back and make it relevant to the students. So as far as I'm concerned, you answered most of my questions. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you for a job well done.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Are there any other questions or comments for the board?
Yeah.
Thank you all for your time, and thanks for your dedication to the kids. At this time, we'll backtrack for our superintendent's report this evening.
Thank you. I have a couple items that I wanted to report. Monday night, I was invited to the PTA committee meeting at the elementary school, and there was even a sheet cake with a welcome for the new superintendent. So it was great. I plan to attend the PTA meetings 7 hours over the course of a year. Is a worthwhile investment, and we can act as a liaison from the board, from administration, to the PTA, and I'm delighted to have that opportunity. Last night, I attended the open house at the senior high school, and I was very impressed with the level of participation. There's a good spirit in that building. It was happy to see our young people engaged. They acted as guides during the evening, and it's a very worthwhile experience to attend. So I encourage viewers, board members, all to take advantage of these meetings, the PTA as well as an open house. Subsequent to the preparation of this agenda, our athletic director has advanced nominations, and Mr. Chair, you do have those nominations for coaching for fall, winter, and I believe spring as well. A couple positions yet to be filled, and we're advertising for those positions.
Jamie Hayes is here as our athletic director. We thank you for giving us your time tonight. You give us just a few moments to go over these because the board has just received them. We'll be right with you. Just I've got a couple of questions. If you want to step up, we'll just, I guess we'll just take them as they come if you folks have questions or comments. Can you give us an idea? Do you want a copy of this? You can refer to it, Jamie.
Thank you.
Jamie, how many of these are returning coaches and how many are new to us this year? Because I think we reapprove coaches on a yearly basis because they're an at-will position.
Right. Let's see, I'll take them season by season. Fall, Randy Edgley is new to the junior high boys. He's actually, I did it last year, and he, when he stepped down from athletic director, he said he would fill that position. So he filled that one. James King, one of our alumni, has stepped up and taken over our junior high cross country program. Previous to just this week, Karen Blackwood, our varsity coach, was doing both teams. So that's been a nice relief for her. She appreciated that. Everyone else in the fall is returning.
I was going to say, I thought I recognized most of the names.
Yeah.
So.
Yep. In the winter season, everyone is returning. We do have a junior high girls basketball position open that has been advertised. Junior high spirit, I've put in a call to the last year's coach, and she has not returned my call yet, so I'm not sure that as far as that, but we did advertise it just in case. And as far as varsity spirit, you may see that's missing from the list. I had a interest meeting in the school, and I had two girls that were definites to participate. And and another girl that was a maybe, and a lot of girls said no, they're just not gonna do it. So we did not advertise that position. In the spring, JV baseball is open. I've heard that Peter Culbert, through the rumor mill, that he's not going to do it. But I'm still waiting for a call back on him. So I did advertise that one just in case. And we're looking for a junior high softball coach. Our previous coach has moved on to a different district from teaching. So that is open also. But everything has been advertised.
I'll make a motion to accept all nominations as presented.
I can second that motion.
Discussion? I've just one last question.
Sure.
Can you sort of, just for the viewers at home, we sort of know how this works because we see this process on a regular basis. We have some new coaches, mm-hmm. some that are certainly new to us and some that are returning. And when a coach is new, what kind of background check and reference check process do you utilize? Because it's a little different than a teaching position in terms of, you know, the nature of how we screen those applicants. So
I would actually pretty much follow the same process. They have to submit a letter of interest with a resume. We would go through an interview process with myself, and if it's a sub varsity position, I'd have the varsity coach there or another administrator if it is a varsity position, and formulate a committee. And I would do reference check, and they'd have to be fingerprinted and background checked, and they have to have CPR, first aid, and coach's principal's course. So there is quite a bit that goes into the hiring of a coach.
Thank you. We knew all that, of course. I think it was just important for folks at home to hear that it's it's not just a, hey, you want to throw the ball around kind of situation.
Right.
Sometimes it was that way when we were growing up. But Chet?
Yeah.
On the varsity cross country and junior high cross country, they all go together, boys and girls? One bus, or how does that go?
Those are actually two separate teams.
Okay.
And they go to separate meets. We have high school meets, and then we have separate junior high meets.
But the varsity one, the girls and the boys go.
Yes, they are. They're co-ed meets. So they have separate races. The girls will have a race at one point, and then the boys will go after, or vice versa. But the junior high and the varsity do not travel together.
Okay.
Just the boys and the girls. We actually currently do not have any girls running for us at the high school level this year. So we only have just a boys team this year.
Any further discussion? We have a motion and a second to approve the nominations as presented. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Jamie, while you're here, can you outline briefly some of the cost-saving measures that you've implemented with scheduling and transportation this year?
Yeah, we've particularly tried to combine as many trips as we can, especially with the football shuttle. A lot of times we have trips going out towards Epping, so they will drop off football on the way. as well as scheduling, just trying to get as many home games on the same day, so when people are covering the games as well. And at the junior varsity level, we're trying to schedule more local schools instead of playing, Moultonboro JV that's an hour and a half away. We'll play Oyster River's freshman team or Exeter's freshman team, and try to keep them more local to save on bus costs, as well as opportunity for parents to go watch at a closer venue, and less travel time for the students so they can get out and get back sooner.
I think someone had mentioned this last time. And we're midway through we're in well to the fall season now. Yeah. Certainly, you don't have to come back to provide this, but if we could get some participation numbers,
sure,
for the individual sports, I think that would be helpful.
Yeah, Chris had given them in the last
meeting.
Chris and we gave them the
last time.
Yeah.
Okay.
But
I guess I didn't remember. I apologize.
But I could certainly, if you need them again, I can provide
them.
When
winter comes around, if we've had them, I'm sure I wrote them down and
sure.
I just forgot. Because I think
sure.
maybe I'd ask for them the meeting before that then.
Okay.
Thanks.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane.
I just have a thought as to what are the girls doing for sports if there's no one on spirit and no one on cross country. I know we just, put the initiative for football and they've got golf. I'm not sure if there's any girls on the golf team, but it'd be nice to see what the girls are interested in doing. As providing mm-hmm. that activity, gives them that more balance.
Yes. Good.
The next item on our agenda is Clay Mitchell, which is the energy proposal. Unfortunately, he's unable to be here tonight due to, I believe, a conflict that came up. And we're not going to have that presentation certainly tonight. Mr. Yes. Superintendent, you have a...
Oh, that's correct. I'm meeting with Clay tomorrow at 9 a.m. And he'll give me an overview of past presentations that he has made to you, others in the district, and he will be available for our October 2nd meeting.
And this is just for the elementary school, right?
Yes, it is.
Anything further in the superintendent's report?
No, there is not. Thank you.
Okay. Correspondence.
You have in front of you material that was sent to the chair of the board, myself, that you, I'm sure, have seen in previous years related to resolutions, call for resolutions from New Hampshire School Boards Association. So this is for your information and consideration in terms of any resolutions that you might want to consider. Believe this is time sensitive as well. Thank you.
October 24th is the deadline.
Yes.
If there's any proposed resolutions that need to be considered by the delegate assembly, for those folks at home, the New Hampshire School Boards Association has one representative from each board that performs the delegate responsibility, and they do have a yearly assembly, and they then formulate those items as resolutions which they would like to see legal action on in the legislature, either at the state level or federally. And so if you have anything that you would like to have considered, please don't hesitate. I'm going to speak for Cliff. Don't hesitate to contact Cliff and let him know that you have something for consideration.
I think Cliff had said that one of the, just for an example, is the reduction of health care.
Yes,
costs.
And that's present. That is in this package.
Okay, and that was something that had been proposed, I believe, by a prior school board in our town.
That's
yep.
right.
Okay.
Right.
And there will also, I'm certain, be something in there along, in the final drafts along the line of the reauthorization of this Elementary and Secondary Schools Act at the federal level, better known as No Child Left Behind, as that's coming up for reconsideration within the next 18 months, if I'm not mistaken. Any further correspondence?
No, thank you.
Yes, Chet.
Let's see, the October 24th is the deadline. October 2nd, can we talk about this a little bit? Because I like us as a group to send one in regards to the state's funding of small schools with the 30%, just 30%.
Thank you, Chet.
I think we should bring something up.
That's a wonderful idea. Thank you.
Are you talking about funding as far as
building?
Building?
Yeah.
Anything else on this? Business department update, Sue?
Sure. You should have had in your packets a copy of the breakdown on a new negotiated lease for our copiers in all of the buildings. Do you all have that? It's kind of a rundown, a little comparison of where we currently are. Do you? Okay. And what we've done, about 3 years ago, we worked with a company called SPC, Specialized Purchasing Consultants, and they went in our buildings and looked at our copiers and did an analysis of what we had, because at the time we were struggling with not having enough copiers, and the copiers that we had were being overloaded with the number of copies we were making on them. So periodically they come back and reevaluate the situation, and they've come back. I know it hasn't been the 5 years, because it is a five-year lease, but at the time when we went into negotiations with them last time, we had a number of copiers that were older that they bought out, and we knew that we were going to be back talking to them sooner than 5 years. And that's where we are right now. We have a number of copiers in our buildings that just aren't doing what we need them to do. They're breaking, and we have a lot of people in there making repairs. So I just had them go out there. They were doing this. They do this for a lot of the schools in Maine. I think, Mark, you're familiar with that. And Exeter and quite a few schools, Oyster River, they've joined and started to approach copiers in this way. Again, they're independent from copier salesmen, so they kind of do an analysis of what we have in our buildings and try to give you the best cost for what you need. And as a result, they've come up with a better situation for us. If you went through it at all, you'll see that we're going to get more copiers in the building so that we take the load off the heavy volume copiers. And then they're also proposing a number of network printers to take some of the load off the copiers and then make it easier on us as far as having those individual printers in all the classrooms so that we have the bigger printers with more capabilities, and cost-wise, the cost per copy comes down. So that's what this proposal is in a nutshell. It was pretty... It's not like they came in and walked around for a couple of hours. They spent about a day here when they did this and actually interviewed staff and went around and asked what they would like to see, you know, their wish list. I have all of that here if you're interested in that. And this is what they came up with. What they need in order to move forward and allow Mark and I to make a decision is for you to adopt this and give us your permission to negotiate a new lease with them. It doesn't necessarily mean we're going to go with what they proposed, but it gives us up to a certain amount, which ends up being, as you can see on the bottom part of the cost center, the present and the proposed cost. The proposed cost is to be less than what we're currently paying. Now, I'm not so sure that's going to happen, because you may find that people use them more, so the lease is a little bit more, but I need to do more investigating on that and look at, you know, their actual proposal. But in order to do that, they have to come back in and we have to negotiate. But first, we need your permission to be able to do that. So that's why I've given that to you. I actually have a resolution here that needs to be in the minutes. And actually has a breakdown. I included a breakdown with it on the cost of the lease. And again, it is a five-year lease. So as leases go, we need to have it in the minutes for your approval. I don't think you have to read the whole thing in order to have that in the minutes, but the first sentence, right? Correct, Mark?
You're correct.
It is a little lengthy, but legally you have to know what you're getting into. Any questions? Any comments? Again, it doesn't necessarily mean that that's the dollar amount will come to at the end. We'll probably do a little adjusting and changing once we talk to the building principals. You know, they went out there and talked with the staff, and we may not have room for some of their suggestions. I think they proposed two copiers in the office, and we already know that we probably can't fit two copiers in both offices, so those are, we had to tweak it a little, but
I personally worked with this organization, and it's correct. There's a lot of cost saving opportunity that can be achieved.
You know, when I have gone in to do some of the helping in the classroom, and I'll go down to the copy room, I was surprised that, I'm not sure what they consider the high efficiency copiers, but when you would go in and put a copy in and it would spit out, you know, the 20 copies you need, it was very slow.
That was one of the complaints, yes.
Okay, and there are machines, I know, mm-hmm. where I was at my other school, called Riso machines, where you put it in and it's like 2 seconds and there's 100 copies right next to you. So I don't know if that's what they're talking about. Are they changing?
A couple of them are for faster machines. I know what you're talking about when you talk about the rezos, and we had those in Forest. You probably had those, and those are kind of not something that we would encourage anymore. We had some difficulties with those. I don't know if you experienced that in your ability.
I think you had one or two staff members trained as to how to keep that working.
My memory serves me correct. Certainly they've gone out of use in many, if not most places now. Cost of operation on the rizos actually is greater normally than the copy machine. While the rizos can be seen as faster, they're certainly also not as versatile as a copy machine, where you can go double-sided very easily. You can use those kind of functions to conserve your paper and your resources. The rizos are fast, but they're also fairly simple, and they are more expensive to maintain normally.
Well, these collate to the staple.
Yeah, that's
great machines.
And that's a couple of options that we've added to a couple of the copiers. Ours are older, the ones we have in the buildings. They don't all do that. And I know in most cases they did step up the speed, because that was one of the major things that people said they had a problem with.
And one of the reasons they're becoming more expensive, because they're in such shorter use now that supply and demand, mm-hmm. it's driving up the cost of those supplies for them now, because mm-hmm. it's a limited, very limited market now. In fact, in Manchester, it was, does anyone have any old leftover Rizzo stuff? Because we can't find any new stuff to fix and run our Rizzos.
Chad.
So what kind of control do we have on these machines? In other words, do we have accounters for them,
yes,
and so forth?
Yes.
We do.
And they maintain all of that for us. And they're actually, they call each school and get the counts, and then they report back to us. And that's primarily why I like this, is because they understand it and they know it. I certainly don't have time to do that. And they'll look at a machine and they'll know that it's not being used enough, and we'll swap them and trade them around to be sure that, you know, we're utilizing them.
Yeah, I was also interested in probably them being abused, the usage for the, not used for the teaching of children. That's what I was thinking of. Mm-hmm. Is that a possibility?
All people using them for their personal use.
And I mean, that's hard to monitor.
Yeah, that's an article of faith.
Yeah.
You know, we hope that there isn't that abuse. But there's codes, there's, you know, security devices, so a passerby simply can't access these machines.
We used to have that. I think in the past, we always used to have that little key where you had to put it in and put in your numbers. Yeah. But, you know, I'm not so sure. That was sort of cumbersome, and I think we've gotten away from that. Certainly the cost per copy has come way down, so that and it's far more efficient to use these opposed to your printers. The laser printers, the cost per copy is very expensive, sure. So we encourage them to use the copy machine. And we actually network them. So, for instance, I can print to the copier from my system rather than the laser printer, because that is far more expensive. So that's the goal that we have, is to use these more than individual printers.
Yeah. One of the side benefits also of SBC is that if there's an issue with the manufacturer, they are the go-between. If there's a defect, we don't have to negotiate corrective action. They do that for us.
So let me ask a question. The numbers that we're looking at here are about changing the copy machines and the supplies that they'll be utilizing. But do we pay this vendor for the service?
It's all worked into the contract. It's part of it. It includes the service.
And that's in these numbers here that you're giving us.
Yes, in that bottom, and you can see in the bottom. And as I said, it's based on how much you currently use, and what they propose would be the same at the different cost per copy, because you're taking the usage off the machines.
Yeah. At this point, as I understand it, there's certainly any further discussion that's welcome. If not, you're looking for a motion to allow you to enter into negotiations to come up with a lease for an amount not exceeding, and we can choose the appropriate dollar amount for the motion. Do I understand that correctly?
That's correct.
I think it's in your resolution there, isn't it, the amount? The total package, that one, right? Doesn't it say for the five-year lease? It's a five-year lease.
And this will be brought back to you for your consideration. So we are not signing off on this lease.
Right.
This is for negotiation purposes only.
So we're not asking for the approval of a lease tonight. We're asking for, if we make the motion, approval to enter negotiations to come to a lease agreement, which will then come back to us for further consideration.
So moved.
With the, do you want it, the dollar amount?
Yeah, not to exceed.
With the dollar amount not to exceed $160,487.59?
Yes.
Right. Penny, you have a copy of this, so you have that dollar figure? Okay, thank you.
Second that.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you.
Motion passes, and we move on to the budget update.
Well, at the last meeting, I talked to you about the MS-25 and the DOE-25, and you, most of you came in and signed it. It's gone, but I wanted to just give you a copy of the condensed version of the 27-page DOE-25 called the MS-25, just so you can see where we ended up prior to the audit for the 07-08 school year. The first page is the balance sheet, and the important part is line 31, total fund equity, which would be the fund balance of $192,003. Of that, $115,203,000 will go into your three warrant articles. As you recall, you only had three approved. And then $76,800 will be applied to the tax rate. So, that fund balance, if you basically, that is a result of excess revenues, mostly impact fees. That was to the tune of $100,000. The breakdown on the revenues can be seen on the second page. We did have some additional tuition, and then if you go to the fourth page, you'll see the breakdown on the expenditures. Includes all funds, general fund, food service, special revenue. And at the next meeting, we'll be, no, it's not the next meeting, I think it's the second meeting. We've asked Linda Dodds to come and speak to you. And you can see in her fund, she does have a fund balance, which is unusual for food service to have a fund balance for food services. I don't know if you've read about other districts suffering from huge deficits. We're very fortunate that she currently has a $14,000, 145 surplus. But with the price of food and the cost of gas, I think this year she did have a small loss. I think it was about $1,800. She had a lot. She's had been carrying a fund balance for a number of years. She did have a couple of equipment problems this year too. So, but she will be here in the second meeting in October.
And that is quite an accomplishment, on this size budget, to have a positive fund balance.
Sue, there's no loss of participation in the lunch, is there, this time?
Well, that's, Linda could speak to you about that, but by loss, do you mean
less students taking lunch?
It's hard to tell. I mean, that's one of the things she'll talk to you about, what her current participation rate is. Actually, when she was in the other day, I think participation was up. She did say participation at this point. Is there anything else that you'd like to have her to speak to? I mean, she did ask me.
Give us a chance to digest.
Okay, but if there is, just let me know. And I mean, she's going to be here in the second.
I think there was a when we looked at the when we were looking at the cost increases. I think that we had wanted an explanation as to why the cost increase was a dollar versus 50 cents when the hot lunch went up 50 cents, but the milk went up, or something changed by a double percentage.
And speaking of digestion, we've asked Linda to also give us a breakdown, and she's working on preparation of basic nutritional information that will be posted along with the menu. So you have a basic idea, you know, of carbs, fat content, and we have some information that we did send to her, and we hope to develop that as well.
Good.
And the next thing is the budget schedule. We're currently in the process of developing the 2009-2010 school budget. A couple of things. Our first work session is scheduled at the elementary school, and I had talked with Scott and Mark, and we thought we would start at maybe 6:30 and invite members of the budget committee and the board if they wanted to tour the building for like a half hour. I didn't know if you were, if we could be there if anyone wants to see it. I think we've done that in the past. And then the second session with the high school, we do the same thing.
Great. Idea.
That's a great idea.
Okay. So I will schedule those for 6:30. I added a few sessions. I think Forrest, you had asked me, because we always seem to get to the final hour. Yeah.
About November 18th is sort of open to give us an overflow opportunity.
Okay. And I mean, certainly
this. Inevitably, the last 3 years, we've needed an extra night.
Yeah.
And sometimes we didn't take it, I think, to our detriment.
Mm-hmm. And I assume 7 on all of them is fine. We start at 7. And
what's the date on that again, Linda?
Well, they're all different.
I mean, Sue.
Your schedule, they're all different. Oh. Schedule, the different dates.
I got you.
The 9th, the 23rd, the 30th. No, the 30th isn't the tour, though. Just the 9th and the 23rd are the ones that start at 6:30.
Right, mm-hmm. Those would be at 6:30.
Chet, did you have the one like this in your packet?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the one where we're working at the high school for the tour is also the same night as the elementary open house.
Yeah, I wondered about that, because
if people had wanted to go and see the facility and maybe attend part of the meeting, it's obviously going to conflict for a lot of parents, especially mm-hmm. those elementary parents.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if that's something that we could flip-flop the special ed and the high school. Mm. Just an idea.
We can.
We can.
Well,
sure.
You know, but it's not really... It's not really the public is certainly invited to attend, but that's not really who attends these work sessions. So, you know, so I don't think we should disrupt our schedule for that. I don't think it's necessary. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I guess my question is, it's a public meeting, so people can come if they want it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
At this point, I would also hesitate to flip-flop things, because we have, the budget committee has had these dates and have set time aside, and the committee may be looking at certain people attending certain ones as opposed to all of them. If we flip them, some of that planning may then go awry. So.
Mm-hmm. So should I just leave it at this point?
Hmm?
Just leave it as it is?
Okay. I'd say so.
Is there a consensus any other way? Leave it as is.
Leave it as is, yeah.
Generally? Okay.
Forrest, are you, who's the budget committee rep?
I'm sorry?
Are you the budget committee rep? Have you had a meeting lately?
We have had, yeah, we've had 2.
Okay.
So that, they're aware of this. They did, the last one was when you came.
Okay. Oh, okay.
There's no plan to meet again until now after we've had our work sessions and they've participated in it. Okay.
So I will email this to,
yes.
Yeah,
to
everyone.
Lorraine Capriola.
Yeah. Okay.
Sorry, Anne, excuse me.
At August 11th meeting that we attended.
All right. Yes. Yep. Do we have a manifest for September?
Yes.
We do.
And I will make a motion to approve the total of all manifests for $304,211.15.
I'll second that motion.
Motion and second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? Calendar for September and October. As we quickly approach October. Sean, is there anything on the school side that we should be aware of? I know this isn't necessarily your night for your formal report, but nonetheless, I think Spirit Week or something's coming up?
Spirit Week
is that in October?
That's actually next week.
Next week.
22nd through the 26th, and the homecoming dance wraps it up on the 27th. And I guess the only major event going on at the school that I don't see on the calendar for October is the senior class. My class is actually putting together a film festival on the 24th of October, which is a Friday night. We just started advertising that this week, and we're trying to spread the word as much as we can. So I guess that could be added as well.
Can you tell us a little bit about that? What's?
Yeah, basically we're looking for entries for short films. There was some confusion at first. People thought they were actual motion pictures.
Yeah.
But we're looking for short films, 10 minutes or less, preferably produced by students. And we're hoping to shoot for 10 films, but it looks the realistic approach, I would say, is probably we're hoping for about 6 or 7. And I know there's a couple groups of students that are working on them actively. I'm helping out with one of them. So, yeah, I can bring you more details at the next meeting, but it looks like it's going to be a good event. So,
fun.
With Linda not having a senior this year, we've lost our connection to project graduation. So I believe, and yeah, don't quote me as gospel, I'm sure you can find out somewhere, there's a bake-off coming during the Heritage Festival that flyers were sent home soliciting entries in the bake-off. Best Desserts of the Sea Coast or something along those lines. I glanced at it.
And it's this Friday night, and you know, it probably starts around 6 o'clock. Yeah, 6 o'clock, and, you know, if you didn't go last year, honest to God, it is so much fun, and the desserts are fantastic. You pay, I can't remember what the prices are, it's like $5 or something, and you get a plate, and you can have as many, you can sample as many of the desserts as you want, and it's just it's a really good time, and I hope everybody goes. It's a great fundraiser for these guys, and it's a lot of fun.
Very good.
In general, it's probably worth noting this weekend is the Heritage Festival,
right.
Taking place downtown all weekend, and it's a fun place to stop by and to see what's going on, from the different bands and musical groups to the booths and displays that people put up, and it's always worth a couple of hours to walk around and see what's going on, several times perhaps. Anything else for the September calendar? Any adjustments to the October calendar or additional activities we don't have listed? Mr. Superintendent, do we have need for a non-public session this evening?
We do not.
Is there any other business to bring before the board? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion for adjournment.
So move.
Okay, I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.